Thank you very much. Thank you for coming out on this very chilly Thursday morning. Before we get started on my presentation, Tubas on the Rise, the significance of tuba playing in Mexican-American music, I'd like to thank the Army Band for inviting me to come give this presentation. I'd like to give a special thank you to Staff Sergeant Jeffrey Keller for the work he's doing back there on the audio. It's going to run really nice and smoothly, and we're going to thank him for that because it's going to work great and it's going to be fantastic. I also like to thank you and I for helping fund this trip so that I can make it out here and give this presentation to you this morning. I'm going to try to make sure that we make it through this presentation in a timely enough manner so that if there are questions at the end, we can have a little bit of time for that. So if as we go you have questions and you want to ask them, we'll try to reserve some time for that. If we happen to run out of time because I talk too much or get lost on a tangent, then come find me afterwards. I'd be happy to discuss any of the things that we talk about here with you afterwards. So the main point from today's presentation that I'd like you to take from it is I'm going to talk about how in many genres, specifically in banda, tuba, an instrument that is a traditional part of that genre, has really changed in significance, and how that change in the playing and in the use of the tuba, we can see it as a signifier of how the tuba means more in Mexican-American culture, especially Mexican-American music culture, now in the 21st century than it has in the past. Obviously, in order to get there, we're going to have to talk about a number of different things along the way. We'll do a brief synopsis of some of the history of these genres. We're going to do some listening to different examples of tuba playing and electric bass playing to show you some of the differences. And then we'll get into talking about the cultural significance and where you're going to hear and see tuba playing in Mexican-American regional music. So first, what is Mexican-American regional music? It's kind of an ethnomusicological term. We use it to describe the many different genres of Mexican music of Mexican origins. Most of this music happens to come from the northwest part of Mexico. It can mean anything from mariachi to banda to norteña to sireña to tejano to many others, Durango. There's many different genres. In particular, today we're going to talk about banda, of course, because that is the genre that we most typically see tuba in. And then norteña and sireña, which are one of them. Sireña is a much newer genre, and the norteña is a traditional genre as well, where we're going to see tuba playing where it hadn't existed before. So not only is tuba going to show up in genres where you wouldn't expect tuba, where you hadn't seen it in the past, but we're going to see it change its role within a traditional genre such as banda. Within all of these genres, one of the main song styles, one of the really important features of Mexican-American regional music is what's called corridos. Corridos are songs that have a very formulaic structure. They're often talking about the troubles of migrant life or lots of just storytelling life aspects. There's some correlations that you can draw between a corrido song style and like maybe country western music and the sort of structures that you see within those song styles. And so corridos is a very traditional genre of songs. You'll see it in traditional banda music and traditional norteña music, and it's something that's very important to this particular style and genre of music. Let's talk a little bit about banda history. It comes from northwest Mexico. There's many different states in northwest Mexico, and different, slightly different versions of banda existed in many different states in this part of the world. Going way back to the mid to late 1800s, there was a large influx of European immigrants in this part of Mexico. Along with many aspects of culture, they brought with them instruments, specifically brass and woodwind instruments, and song styles like polka and waltz and those Central European dance styles. They brought those with them. When they came to this part of Mexico, they started forming bandas populares with some of the people that were already living in this area. So in these small towns, you would have groups of amateur musicians who would get together and play in these bandas populares just for fun, for important festivals in the town, for family gatherings. Very amateur musicians, but the sort of music that they really enjoyed playing was a mix of Central European music and traditional Mexican music, using mostly brought over instruments from Central Europe. As we fast forward a little bit to the turn of the 20th century, a lot of the young men, especially in this part of the country, left their rural villages because they were called to go fight in the Mexican Revolution. When they went to fight, some of them would end up playing in bands or would be exposed to different music styles, different instruments, and just a different way of life when they left the rural villages and went to Mexico City or other larger cities in Mexico. Upon their return back to their home villages or back to the northwest part of the state, they brought these styles with them, a sense of a patriotic music and Mexican nationalism they brought back with them and changed some of the styles of the music that was being played in these small towns. In addition to that, after the revolution, the Mexican-American government, or the Mexican government, excuse me, decided that they were going to kind of rebrand the bandas populares and to try to help build nationalist sentiment. So they kind of renamed these groups, called them bandas municipales. They still played at important town functions and local gatherings, but they played more patriotic music, more Western-influenced music, classical music. It's just a slight change in the style of music that was being played. These military ensembles were then kind of left on their own. There's a period of time in the early 20th century where the Mexican government had other concerns and wasn't quite as focused on what these small groups were doing, and they're so remote and isolated out in the mountainous region in northwest Mexico that they were kind of left to do what they wanted and develop as they wanted to and kind of mix with the local culture as they needed to. This kind of geographic isolation and a little bit of government indifference allowed banda that we know today to form. So of all the different states and all the different areas, banda sinaloense, banda from the state of Sinaloa, is the banda that we know today. When you think of a banda ensemble, that is what you're hearing. Traditionally, it was a group of 9 to 12 musicians. Today, it might even be 15 or 17 musicians, depending on the particular banda. Clarinets, trumpets, valve trombone, alto horn, drums, tuba. Eventually, singers and other instruments were added. But traditionally, just instrumentalists first. The same sort of function of playing at local events, playing at parties, at quinceañeras, at really culturally significant events in these rural Mexican towns. The very first truly important and really famous banda was Banda El Recodo de Cruz Lizarraga. Cruz Lizarraga was the band founder and organizer of this band. He did a number of different things. So he started having the group accompany vocalists, which they found to be quite successful. And then they decided, well, we should probably record with vocalists. This is something that really helped their group in particular become not only one of the first recorded banda ensembles, but then very, very popular within the Mexican-American community. He instituted standardized uniforms, which was very controversial at the time, but if you see or think of banda today, one of the first things that you think of is the often very flashy, very colorful, coordinated suits of a specific color or style. It's something that is very much a standard banda style today. And he started that, this is in the 1920s. He also introduced a lot of big band charts and popular dance songs to get these banda ensembles a little bit away from some of the traditional music and more towards what he perceived the audience is wanting to hear. And so all the combination of all these things made this group very popular, and this is still one of the most important banda groups today. So it still exists as Banda El Recodo de Cruz Lizarraga. He is obviously no longer with us, but the group continues in his name. One of the kind of unfortunate parts of Mexican-American music culture is narcocorridos, and we'll talk a little bit about them now and come back to it later. There was a number of banda groups, El Recodo de Cruz Lizarraga not being one of them, but a number of groups who decided that the power of the cartel, which is something that is a very real and a very powerful part of especially the northwestern states of Mexico and Mexican culture, that this was a way to become rich and famous, and for a lot of them has been very successful. A lot of these cartel parties were very lavish, very extravagant, would feature banda groups. A lot of the cartel leaders would commission songs, these narcocorridos, by the bandas, and they would be very formulaic. They'd be about, making lots of money, killing lots of your enemies, selling lots of drugs, the sort of things you might expect a narcocorrido to be about. It's a very dangerous and unfortunate lifestyle. This started as something that banda groups would do to kind of become famous and to help them get a name. And then as we get into the 20th and 21st century, it has become much different and much more dangerous. We'll talk more about that as we get later. Through the mid-20th century, banda grew in popularity, mostly because of groups like Banda El Recodo. It became more culturally significant because you would see it more, be performed more at important culturally significant events. It just became a more prominent part of Mexican-American music culture. A lot of times we think of mariachi as one of the most popular Mexican-American music genres, and that is the genre that the Mexican government would often portray as traditional Mexican music. But banda kind of did some catching up in the 20th century and in some ways has perhaps surpassed mariachi as we get into the 21st century. An important thing to remember, though, all these changes in banda music, not much has changed in the tuba parts over these 50 to 100 years. We're going to look at some examples in just a minute, where the banda part that you would hear in 1950 versus the banda part you'd hear in 1980 versus what you'd hear in the early 1900s, not a whole lot of difference. It's very basic harmonic support, not a whole lot of technique, not what you hear today in banda music. So one of the other most important genres is norteña. Norteña is also a genre of music from northern Mexico. It's a much smaller ensemble than banda. This is going to come into play in modern Mexican-American regional music when there's pretty significant economic considerations to take into account. This genre traditionally was considered like a music or a migrant class, a music that was with the migrant audience that went back and forth across the border as they did manual labor from farming to whatever needed to be done. And this music really focused on the corridos. And these corridos helped tell the stories of these migrant workers and help kind of build a cultural identity for this particular group of people. The norteña ensemble traditionally includes accordion, guitar, saxophone, and electric bass. And so that's something that is, you know, traditionally a significant difference from banda. You wouldn't traditionally ever see a tuba play in a norteña ensemble. Hint, that is something that will change. Los Tigres del Norte is one of the most famous norteña groups. They really came into popularity in the 70s and 80s in Los Angeles and in the southwestern United States. They were Mexican immigrants themselves, and they really helped represent kind of the hopes and dreams of a lot of the people in this Mexican-American migrant group of people. They focused on corridos and then specifically narco corridos. They were one of the groups that decided that they were going to use this wealth and power from writing narco corridos to help bolster their careers and make them more powerful and more famous group. They have fared much better than many groups who have done this. There are some musicians that we'll talk about later on who have had some of the ugly, unfortunate sides of the narco culture affect their lives. But Los Tigres del Norte were able to use this as a way to gain power and gain money and gain popularity. We're going to take a look at two different early examples. These are going to be very representative of traditional banda and traditional norteña music. So first, the banda example, Que me acabe la vida by Banda El Recodo. What you're going to hear and see, very basic harmonic and rhythmic support, not a whole lot of embellishing.
Que se me acabe la vida frente a una copa de vino y que te diga el destino que vas a vivir sin mí. Que se me cierren los ojos que fueron tu gran cariño y que se sienta en tu pecho de veras que ya me fui.
So the kind of tuba part that we could probably all pick up our instrument and play without too much trouble. That's going to end pretty quickly. These parts get very complicated very quickly. The next example is from a similar vintage of Los Tigres del Norte. What you're going to see is a bass part that is slightly more active, but very, very similar in its function. Harmonic support, a few passing tones, but really essentially the same function within the group. So for about 60 or 70 years, from the 1920s up until the 1980s and early 90s, this is generally what you would hear in the bass line in tuba and bass playing in these particular genres of music. Very basic, lots of harmonic support, not a lot of interesting embellishments. Very background role within the ensemble. In the late 80s and early 90s, a new genre came onto the scene. This genre was kind of the instigator of a lot of the change that we're going to hear in the actual parts within the banda and the bass role within the ensemble. Techno banda is a new style of banda music that came into popularity, specifically in L.A. So KLAX was a brand new radio station in the early 90s, and techno banda took this station from essentially a nothing radio station to the number one L.A. radio station in a number of months. And the reason for this is this music was incredibly popular with the young Mexican-American audience. It was performed at clubs. It kind of took banda music from a rural traditional music that was maybe kind of at that time seen as like their parents' or grandparents' music and brought it into the modern times in the 90s and brought it into the clubs in L.A. and made it incredibly popular. Along with it came a dance that was kind of the craze of the 90s in the Mexican-American music culture, the quebradita. So we're going to listen to just a little bit of the techno banda just to get an example of what this sounded like. And there might be a YouTube ad.
I think we should have a photo.
No, no, don't use that. Let's use one of the ones online.
Like I can just take a picture now. No, but I can just take it. I can just take one now.
So you hear a couple things right away, right? The really amazing synthesizers and the cool electronic effects, right? That's one of the key points of techno banda, right? The techno added to the name. But also a much more active bass line, right? That's different from what we heard in the first Norteña example. You may have also noticed that that was not tuba, right? One of the things that techno banda did was it took out a lot of the instruments. So a lot of the traditional instruments in a banda would have gone from 9 to 12 musicians all the way down to 5 or 6. Made it a much smaller ensemble, a lot of electronic keyboards, electric bass, made it much more easy to be portable to go from club to club, and it wasn't quite as an expensive venture to have a techno banda be hired to play at your quinceañera or your wedding or whatever event you might want a banda to play at. So it's a much smaller ensemble and a different sound. So it kind of actually, in this time period, went away from what I'm arguing, right? Tuba kind of disappears from the banda scene, and it becomes new and different, and it's much more electronic. What's going to happen is this quebradita dance club scene and the techno banda scene is really important and really intense, and then it fades very, very quickly. Before we get to that, though, I'd like you to see the quebradita so you can kind of get a visual of what this would have looked like.
Música, maestro.
Saluta, uca, uca, saluta, uca, uca, saluta, uca, uca. Que se acabe la tristeza, hay que darle al reventón. Invítame una cerveza, me la tomo de un jalón. Con las cheves y el ritmazo, hasta baila el perezoso. Dale duro al taconazo, con este ritmo sabroso. Vamos a decir salud, ya cantaré uca, uca, arriba la juventud.
So it's a dance style. It's very athletic, very intense. You can imagine a whole nightclub full of people dancing to this style would have been maybe a little dangerous, right? These days, it's something that's used kind of in the, that's an example of kind of like a dance TV show, right? That's a Mexican version of Just Dance or something like that. That is now is a competition sort of piece, but traditionally would have been done in the nightclub with a techno banda ensemble playing. So it changed banda in some ways, because it made a much flashier, much more intense performance. It brought a more upbeat dance style to the banda genre. And obviously, as you heard, a more complex bass part. What happened as we get to the end of the 90s is techno banda faded just about as fast as it came out of the scene. It kind of just disappeared and went away. It became much less popular. And what happened was traditional banda ensembles adapted some of these changes, the style of playing, the particular songs, and adapted those to the traditional banda setting, and then this new version of banda, kind of the modern banda ensemble, became much, much more popular and kind of resurged at the end of the 90s and into the early 2000s and became a much stronger force in the Mexican-American music community. So we're gonna check in here in this is the early 2010s, and this is Banda El Recodo. It's the same group as we heard from the recording previously. This is an example of a modern banda tune. What you're going to hear is a much more active tuba part, a much more intense collaboration in the duets with the other instruments, taking on a melodic role in parts of the third line, and then lots of unison figures with the alto horns and the trumpets at the very end of this one.
¿Para qué me sirve jalarme a la banda tocando corridos por el malecón? ¿Para qué me sirve escolta privada si tu indiferencia mató a nuestro amor?
So, as you heard, unison brass figures, active accompaniment role, and a bit of an important melodic role. And we're going to hear even more of that melodic role here in this next one. So that was just a clip from this song. You'll hear some of that again in this particular example. But what really drew me to this song, and actually one of the things that drew me to this project, was hearing this particular song. And so this is a banda tune. You'd hear it on the radio, something that a really important and famous banda group recorded. And the whole tune starts with a tuba solo.
¿Para qué me sirve mi troca blindada si atravesaste a mi corazón? ¿De qué sirve andar de parranda en parranda con radio colgado si no tengo tu amor? ¿Para qué me sirve calarme a la banda tocando corrido?
And so while we hear this change in the banda scene and how the tuba sounds and its role within the ensemble in the 2000s in banda music, there are some changes in Norteña and in the particular role of the string bass or the electric bass in the Norteña ensemble. This is an example from 2009 of Los Tigres del Norte. And this, what you're going to hear and you're going to see, is a more active part, right? There's clearly more notes on the page. But it doesn't quite have the same melodic role. It is more ornamented and more interesting, but it doesn't have the same melodic component that the tuba part does in banda. This is something that we see a lot in electric bass playing in Norteña, in particular in this time period, that has some of the aspects that the banda music has, but not all of them.
¿Para qué me sirve? ¿Para qué me sirve mi troca blindada?
We'll catch back up here. See the complete and can hear the increased complexity in both, but the change in the significance of the role in the tuba part is more significant. So, in addition to that change in the actual playing, there are some cultural trends and changes that are important as well. Norteña and Sireña, which is a genre we haven't talked about yet, is a genre that is an acoustic genre traditionally. Although it is a relatively new genre in Mexican American music, it's traditionally acoustic guitar, and then like a bajo sexto, which is a kind of acoustic bass guitar, accordion, and vocalist, and that particular ensemble is often adding tuba as well. So these ensembles that didn't have tuba before, that would have just had a string bass, electric bass in them, are replacing those instruments with tuba. A couple reasons why that's happening. Important musicians like Gerardo Ortiz and El Tigre Palma, which are pretty important figures within each of those genres respectively, have done this and taken these ensembles on tour. So they will take a tuba player, add them to their Norteña ensemble, go on a worldwide or a nationwide tour. And so lots of smaller groups, lots of fans of this genre are seeing that and seeing that on a really important and big stage. And music patrons in some places, especially like LA, where this is very much part of the culture, are expecting that, are beginning to expect that for a number of different reasons, because of these large musicians doing it, and because it's something that a lot of fans are desiring, a lot of fans are demanding. When you think about the economic side of it, if you're a middle-class family and you have a quinceañera coming up for your daughter and you want to hire a group, and you can either hire a banda that has 15 musicians or a norteña ensemble that's going to play probably similar tunes, maybe even the same tunes, but there's only like five or six people in that group instead of 15, that's a heck of a lot more affordable and much more reasonable for a family, especially a family that may be on a tight budget, to fit in their possibility for what they can do for any sort of family gathering, whether it's quinceañera, wedding, or another important life event. One of the things that I kept hearing and kept being repeated to me when I was in LA talking to people at banda shows or at norteña shows was that one of the things that they liked most about the tuba, and one of the reasons that they felt that the tuba was most important to being added to norteña and sierreña ensembles, was because the energy of the banda show was what was really desired. The really intense brass playing, the big sound, that was what to them felt like a party atmosphere. That's what they really wanted. And one of the ways that they could get that without having to go to a banda show or without having to have a banda was to take the tuba out of that banda ensemble and put it within these other ensembles. A lot of them felt that the tuba itself, because of the sound and some because of the size and the way it looks, was most effective at carrying that party atmosphere from the banda ensemble over to these other genres. As we all know, there's a very visceral quality to a really loud, intensely played tuba or sousaphone, especially in this case where often the microphone is put inside the bell, and so it's not only blasted but also then blasted through the speakers. And so you get a very different sound at a live show than you'd get on the recording. Some of these recordings, you may notice, are a little bit more refined sounding, more a classical tuba sound. It's not always what you're going to hear when you go to a live show. One of the most interesting things that I observed and saw was this phenomenon of tuba players being beckoned by people in the audience, often people up near the front of the stage or near the performers, being beckoned over to blast and to play their bass lines into the patron's face. Oftentimes this patron would be, you know, a young person, specifically mostly young gentlemen, who really wanted to drink a lot. And they'd have a whole bottle of liquor and they'd be tipping their head back and chugging the liquor while the sousaphone is blasting in their face. And it seems like a pretty strange way to go about drinking your liquor, but imagine the intense sensation of that blasting tuba while you're chugging bottles of whatever liquor you might prefer. After this, then typically, especially if there was someone who was a little bit more well off, sometimes very substantial tip would be thrown into the bell. So Jesse Tucker is one of the people that I interviewed a lot and spent some time with in LA, and he would say that he would often empty his bell at the end of a long night of playing, and he'd have hundreds of dollars of tips just in his tuba bell. So very lucrative as well for tuba players, right? That sounds like a pretty good deal. So it's something that it's just, you know, an interesting side effect or an interesting aspect of this particular why tuba is wanted as part of these shows. And we all know the visual effects, right? Whether it's a beautifully engraved sousaphone like this or some of the really ornately painted and designed sousaphones that you see with these banda and norteña ensembles, it has a really stunning visual effect often. We're going to take a look at Tigrillo Palma, which is one of the sierreña musicians. One of the things that I want you to notice and hear here is, yes, it's a very complex tuba part. It's a kind of virtuosic in its nature. One of the things that this particular tuba player does very well is he does a great job imitating and playing duets with, interacting with the acoustic guitar, which is a staple of this genre. Not exactly the sort of technique you would expect on tuba, right? All that strumming and carrying that over to sousaphone or tuba, you may not think would work that well. We've got a couple examples here showing you of how intense and how well that can be done. So there's that example, and then this next example, you're going to see even more of it. You're going to see the two people are actually kind of taking over from the acoustic guitar and taking over at the end of the example some of those really important filler parts that the acoustic guitar would traditionally play.
Quisiera que cuando llueva en vez de agua cayera perico. Y que corriera cerveza, tequila por mar y ríos. En los jardines hubiera en vez de rosas claveles o lirios.
So obviously, like, quite virtuosic, right? This is not the sort of part that you could just pick up your tuba and play, probably, most of us at least. As I was transcribing it, it took me a while to kind of work through it and to learn to play some of this. But quite different from what we heard before, right? It's a huge jump in technique, but it's also a really interesting way to interact with the other ensembles. It's really making the tuba more an important role, part of the ensemble, rather than just the bass line. Gerardo Ortiz is a very, very famous Norteño musician, travels around the world, tours all over the place, and he has included a couple of banda instruments within his particular Norteño ensemble. This first one features clarinet and tuba in a really kind of beautiful duet here at the beginning of this particular tune.
Todo lo que haces, soy fanático de tus mensajes, tus caricias y tus besos son irreemplazables. Que todo es.
So in addition to that important role at the beginning of that tune, the next one you're going to see, probably the most iconic instrument or here, the most iconic instrument in Norteña really is accordion. So at the very beginning here, the tuba and the accordion have that opening lick together. And as we get to the end of this example, that bridge phrase that you hear at the very first measure, it kind of is the glue that keeps this particular piece together. The tuba takes over that role, and the accordion just kind of disappears from that particular role. So it's kind of an example of the tuba taking that part and just kind of taking that role from the accordion.
A la moda y en buenos cabos, y mis plebes bien armados, bien vestidos y de traje, y por estos pecherados, este spray y sus rosarios.
So, pretty intense, pretty fast, but really interesting use of the tuba in these particular performers. So you have these two really famous performers using tuba in really interesting ways, setting an example for what a lot of music patrons are going to expect and going to want. In addition to that, we see a lot of examples of tuba in advertising. So whether it's a poster like this where La Tuba is the biggest text on the page with a giant picture of a sousaphone, or this one, or Los Fieles de Sinaloa, is a sireña group. It's not a banda, it's not a norteña group. And that sousaphone is part of their logo. Everywhere you see Los Fieles, you see that sousaphone. So it's something that they are actively advertising and making sure that people know that they are a sireña group that has a sousaphone, that has a tuba in their group. An interesting way to use the visual aspect of the tuba in an important way for them to make money. So, As we've listened to and seen a lot of the ways that the parts have changed, we've talked about how it fits within the ensemble and how that has changed, but how does that mean that that's a cultural signifier? How does that mean that this is something that's important to Mexican-American music culture? And some of this is going to be like overt, like it is something that music fans and patrons have decided that is what they want. It's very important in culture because of that. Others are just ways that it connects to traditional Mexican heritage and Mexican culture. So it has an increased use in new and traditional genres, this integral melodic role. It's something that's really important within these new and traditional genres. One of the things that a lot of ethnomusicologists have written about, most notably, Carlos Flores and Kathy Ragland has some as well, about instruments as preservers of traditional culture. So Carlos Flores in particular writes about Tejano music in Texas and how the accordion is kind of a bridge instrument from like popular modern Mexican-American music and the young people who listen to that music and their ancestors and the same styles of music that existed for them, even though they sound different now, how those genres carry through and connect generations. The same sort of thing is happening in banda, something that many young Mexican-Americans, it would have been the music of choice for their grandparents or great-grandparents, and it is again today, even though it sounds different, also the genre and music of choice, and one of the most important connectors there is how important the tuba is and that aspect of the genre. It's a way that, that young Mexican Americans can be, whether it's conscious or not, connected to their Mexican heritage and their Mexican culture. We're also seeing it be performed in many important culturally significant events. I've talked many times about quinceañeras, weddings, other important parties. It's this sort of event where you're seeing tuba almost every time you go to one of these in Southern California in particular. And the interesting thing is this is something that started in Southern California and became incredibly popular there, so much so that it was actually a pretty intense oversaturation. Many of you may remember the stories coming out of like the LA Times about tubas being stolen out of high school band rooms because there was such a demand for sousaphones and for tuba players. And then that very quickly got filled. And now where it was almost impossible to not find work as a banda sousaphone player, now it's hard to find work because there's so many people doing it. So it has spread to other parts of the country with these touring groups and with other parts of the country having picked up on this trend. Then we'll talk a little bit about narco-corridos today, kind of some of the less fortunate aspects of this particular music culture and this style of music. So they have continued to become popular. They are still incredibly popular today. Whether a song you hear on the radio is whether you know it's a narco-corrido or not, a lot of music today is still written in this style for cartel leaders, or if not specifically for cartel leaders, with that sort of trying to gain on that popularity in mind. You can see the picture in the bottom there. This is a Sierrania group that's advertising itself with a bazooka, an AK-47, a guitar, and a sousaphone. So like a pretty intense advertising there, like very blatant about what they are all about, right? And some of the videos of these groups are kind of disturbing, actually. But it's the same style of music. It not knowing the lyrics or knowing the genre too in depth, you would be hard-pressed to hear the difference between the two. A lot of modern artists see this as a way to make a lot of money real quick and become very famous. And to be honest, if they were to find the right cartel leader or the right particular cartel, it is. It can be very successful. There's also, unfortunately, a very real and very dangerous side effect. In the last decade or two, musicians, especially musicians that write for specific cartels, have become targets of gang and cartel violence. Chelino Sanchez, Javier Rosas have lost their lives, or close family members have lost lives. Gerardo Ortiz, who's a famous worldwide musician, has been attacked. He is fine, but like he was in the wrong part of town, and was attacked by a rival cartel. And so it's something that like is very dangerous, and you're taking quite literally your life and your family's lives into your hands if you decide this is the way you're going to go. Obviously, I would not advise that if you decide to go into a career in banda. I talked to a lot of people who go to these shows about this because I was curious about, like, how do you feel about the morals of this? This is something that would seem, you know, kind of immoral to support this music and this kind of activity. And they agreed. They don't agree with the morals. They didn't really like what the side effects were, but they still really like the music because it's so ingrained, the culture is so strong, and they really just love the way that it sounds that they often would still support this music in spite of the negative consequences. Narco-corridos, just like corridos, are another way to connect to a traditional Mexican music culture. The very formulaic storyline and the story writing within these songs is something that happened in the middle of the 20th century and has continued all the way through to modern day, and something another way that we can see a connection between traditional Mexican culture and the music that is popular today. And unfortunately, tuba is a major aspect of narco culture because of its popularity. Another area that this tuba playing in Mexican regional music is expanding is in Mexican-American rap. This is a relatively small genre, but it is one that's growing. Aquid is a pioneering group in this particular genre. And we'll listen to an example and watch a little bit of an example of them playing. And they use a banda-style backing group, which, while not as technically advanced or not as intense as some of the music we've listened to, still does feature the tuba in some ways.
Algo que muchos han tratado. Tal vez no es cuestión de insultar, es tristeza. Vete en tu final, no más.
¿Cómo te puedo pagar todo lo que haces por mí? Todo lo feliz que soy, todo este grande amor. ¿Cómo te puedo pagar todo lo que haces por mí? Todo lo feliz que soy, todo este grande amor.
So interestingly, I've actually recently discovered a group that is a mix of Mexican-American musicians and European musicians who are doing kind of all sorts of crossover music. But one of the things that they're doing is Mexican-American rap with banda accompaniment. So it's an interesting genre that is evolving and changing even like to this day. One of the things that I think works well with this particular genre is that they have a common goal, right, of this party atmosphere. If you're going to a live rap show, like the idea is to go to a party atmosphere, just like a banda show. So having the banda group within that setting and the tuba in particular makes a lot of sense. It's something that really they works well together. As time goes on, this is expanding outside of Southern California, as I mentioned, partially because famous singers go on tour, partially because of the oversaturation in Southern California. One of the other areas that is growing quite rapidly is in South Texas. Some of you may know J.D. Salas, who's written a dissertation on the history of tuba and banda music, or may even know Jose, who's a student at UT River, Rio Grande, down in Brownsville, Texas, studies with Scott Reeder, or studied with Scott Reeder, and he would go play banda shows many nights a week and made a lot of money and paid for a lot of his college that way. He's someone that I talked to about this, and it's something that is happening more and more in the Rio Grande Valley because banda is becoming much more popular there. An area that would have traditionally been very Tejano heavy because that's the style of music that was popular, now banda has become much more popular because of how popular it is around the country. Some of the conclusions that we can draw, the tuba is now an instrument of cultural significance because it's replaced bass guitar in some of these new genres and because of the change of its role within the banda ensemble. Its new melodic role is really crucial to this. It's not just the harmonic background instrument. It's a frontline instrument that plays melodic material that is demanded by an audience. It's something that's really important to this genre. It's demanded at culturally significant events. We see it in these new genres, whether it's Norteña Sierreña or the Mexican-American rap. It's something that is being included in these new developments in this music. And it has this really crucial and important role in the party atmosphere that is one of the main goals of these live music shows. And the tuba is continually a central role in that particular aspect. Thank you very much. Do any of you have questions? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I'm trying to think. I don't know that I can think of an example, whether in a live show or just, you know, through browsing videos on YouTube. I don't think that I have, to be honest with you. I think it is very, very, like you said, machismo, very male-driven, in the bands especially, right? I mean, that's very much part of Mexican-American culture and part of this band culture, unfortunately. One of the interesting things about the group that I mentioned, that's the crossover group of Mexican-American and European musicians, that group in particular does have a mix of male and female musicians, but that is absolutely not the norm. Yeah, it is unfortunately very male-heavy and very male-focused. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of it's by ear. It's, you know, especially like in Southern California, you might, you know, maybe you do some music in the school system growing up, right? But your family listens to banda all the time, or you really like banda music and you go to shows, you maybe, you know, get connected with one of the musicians. And a lot of this training is done by ear. They don't really, like the transcribing that I did, like there aren't really very many transcriptions of banda music. It's a lot of oral theory, knowing the chord changes, knowing the tune, and just improvising a lot of it. Especially on the tuba parts, the bass lines, that's where you see the tubas having a lot of freedom to do that and make their melodic role more interesting. Some of the trumpet parts or some of that might be a little bit more directed rather than improvised. But yeah, it's a lot of oral theory and a lot of, similar to jazz, there's a lot of correlation there. So yeah, I think we had here first then.
So much of banda music is overplayed, mm-hmm. potentially without trombone.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So the mouthpiece that you typically see, not only is it really ornamented so that it kind of is bedazzled and fits the aesthetic, it's really shallow, like kind of incredibly shallow. That allows that more forced tone when it's desired. I don't know so much about the endurance factor. I think that's just kind of like you build that endurance as playing these shows as part of the culture. Jesse Tucker, you may have seen one of the pictures, he'll actually play like a concert tuba, and that is happening a little bit more. As you throw the microphone down the tuba and play with a lot of intensity, you're going to get some of that tone anyways. But that is something that has changed some over the time period, where as Banda from 50 years ago, it would have been very, very focused, very bright, maybe pinched tone, what we might consider. That's true to some extent today, but it's not as much part of the style. And you could hear that in some of the recordings where there's a clear difference in how the tuba sounds. And so it just depends on the band, it depends on the tuba player. But yeah, the mouthpiece is the most important part of that equipment difference. So, yeah.
I was kind of noticing, it seems like the evolution of Banda genre in general, mm-hmm. there's like a lot of strong parallels with brass band genre, as far as mm-hmm. starting out very traditional and vocal,
sure.
very aggressive, where the brass players are ending up basically feeling like rock stars, even merging with the pop genre.
Yeah. You know, I haven't seen that, although it certainly wouldn't be that much of a surprise. Like, just because of the way the group sounds, it does, you know, if you think, especially like New Orleans brass band style, right, there's not that much difference there. You can draw some parallels. I can't say that I've seen them show up in the same sort of place. It has come to the point in Mexican-American regional music where the songs themselves are pretty interchangeable between banda, norteña, sierreña. It's all very interchangeable. You just, you know, have different people playing the parts, so... There's certainly that sort of interchangeability happening. Yeah.
A lot of that music, one of the things I think is most exciting and kind of organic is the solo parts of the fiddle part. As a trained musician, I would never try to know where some of these people
yeah.
the way they do it. The closest thing I see is a parallel to go there. Some of the things that he does with jazz and pedals.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I think so. And I think just the you know, a lot of the licks that you might hear them playing are things that they, you know, they heard maybe their teacher play, or they heard bandas that they really like play. And so it is, it's that oral tradition. And I hear some similarities to traditional New Orleans jazz music, where you'd have traditionally have a sousaphone in that. I hear some parallels there in the way that the bass line is treated, and the way that it maybe goes in a slightly different, the ornamentation might be a little different than a classically trained musician would play or perform or expect. So yeah, I certainly think that's a good point. There's certainly some parallels there. Yeah. So it's still very traditional that it's sousaphone, and often the preferred is, you know, maybe a con or a king, a metal sousaphone, something that's a real big, heavy brass instrument. And piston valve, of course, because of that. It's not, whereas a couple decades ago, it kind of would have been like, you would have been really frowned upon had you brought a concert professional tuba to play a banda show. That's not as unusual anymore. There are more musicians who are doing that, either because that's what they have and they like playing that better than sousaphone, or just because they can do more of the crazy technique stuff, especially in the low range. Jesse Tucker in particular, when I'd go watch him play, not only does he do a bunch of the crazy high melodic stuff, but he does a lot of really intense pedal stuff as well, which is a very different effect and not something you see on some of these professional musicians, not the stuff that you would see recorded on a Gerardo Ortiz CD, but something that in a show that he really likes to do, and is something that's different that he can bring with a concert tuba. So still mostly sousaphone. Yeah. Yeah, Joe. Sure. Yeah, and it's something that I think because it's even kind of new to South Texas, there probably wasn't as much of it when you were there growing up. So when I moved to Texas, one of the first gigs I got called for was a banda gig, and it was not one that ended up working out. Not necessarily because I couldn't have played it or didn't want to play it. It just didn't work out for other reasons. But So like it was like this is something that is here, even though it's something that you think of as being, you know, traditionally Mexican or like Southern California, LA. And I did ethnomusicology as my secondary area for both my master's and doctorate at North Texas. And because of the nature of touring musicians now, there's banda shows all over the place in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And any given night, there's going to be multiple different banda, norteña, sierreña shows. So there's a lot of that music there because of the Mexican-American population. And so it was a nice combination of my two areas of interest in related to music and tuba. And it was pretty accessible because I could go to a lot of different shows while not having to travel all the way to L.A., even though I did eventually, but at the beginning of the project, I didn't have to. So, yeah. And it's music that I enjoy listening to. It's really interesting. It's a cool and different way to use the tuba. And, you know, how often are we the superstars? You know, like, that's few and far between. So that is interesting for that particular reason. So. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. You can see a lot of it on the eBay, on the internet. It's really, some of it's really beautiful artwork. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Very good. Well, thank you very much. Some great questions today. Thank you for being a great audience.